We are not going to gut this law. We will fix what needs to be fixed, but we're going to make the Affordable Care Act work, and those who say they are opposed to it and can't offer a solution, we'll push back.
Welcome back, everybody. Joe Concha filling in for Steve Malzberg, the Steve Malzberg Show, Newsmax TV, Newsmax Radio. Joining us now, Douglas Holtz-Aiken. He is the former director of the Congressional Budget Office and the current president of the American Action Network. Douglas, thanks so much for joining us here on this Friday.
My pleasure. Thank you.
So, I don't know if you heard, there may have been a couple of problems with Obamacare over the last couple of weeks.
Only when you turn on the TV every day.
Yeah, this is easily the low point of the Obama presidency. My question is, you were a former director of the CBO, that, like we talked about, and you read about, surprisingly, that the CBO at one point said that Obamacare would produce a surplus. And I'm wondering, were the variables in that math equation based on numbers that the administration may have provided, that, hey, we're going to get 2.7 million people signed up who are young and healthy, 7 million people overall? Is that where the surplus part came from, or what do you know about that?
Well, I think it came from a number of things. I mean, the first is that CBO has to take whatever is written in legislation at face value, even if it's clearly a budget gimmick. So let's collect taxes on what was known as the Class Act up front and ignore the spending that happens after the first 10 years. Or they have to take at face value promises to cut reimbursements to hospitals so low that even the administration's actuary was saying they're going to go out of business. So we know that's not going to happen. And they have to make some estimates of enrollment. They were the ones who estimated enrollment of, you know, 7 million in the first year, 2.7 young invincibles. The administration then adopted those numbers. But when CBO made that estimate, it had to assume how the administration would implement the law. As we've seen, they haven't implemented it very well. It's been a disaster, and those numbers look very shaky at this point.
So do you see a scenario where, now there's only 100,000 people signed up, I don't know how many young invincibles, and I like that term, are part of that 100,000 number. That's obviously just a fraction of what they need. If the president stands on this and says, no, we're going ahead with this law, we're not going to repeal it, I'm not going to make too many fixes to it just to save face, do we see a bailout coming here at some point? Because obviously the law, with the number of people that are currently enrolled, and they'll get more, I get that, but they're never going to get to that number, it appears. Do we see a bailout in the future here just to keep this law sustainable, to keep it crumbling under its own weight?
I think there are realistically two possibilities, and they're at opposite ends of the spectrum. One I've been worried about since it was passed, is they actually get everything fixed and they continue to have the lavish subsidies they have, and pretty soon nearly every employer in America gives up on the idea of providing health insurance, and they all end up dumping their employees into the exchanges. We can't afford that. That's trillions and trillions of dollars that are not in the CBO estimate or anywhere else, and we just fall under its fiscal weight. The other possibility is things continue as they are right now. And right now what is happening is people who are quite expensive and quite ill are getting the insurance for obvious reasons. The young invincibles, the young and healthy that they need in the insurance pools to pay the bills of these sicker folks are likely not showing up. If they can get their insurance company to keep on their current policy, it's going to be a lot cheaper, and they'll just stay. Or they'll avoid paying for this expensive insurance and simply pay the penalty. But they don't show up and buy insurance. If that's true, then what do you end up with in 2014? Well, you end up with a relatively small program with a lot of sick people in it. Why would an insurance company want to have that as their book of business? They won't. So in 2015, they're not going to show up as much, and we'll get, again, small enrollments of sick people, and we'll end up with a government program for sick people. And that's called a high-risk pool, and that's what Obamacare could turn out to be.
I think the assumption by the Obama administration was that they ran such an effective campaign in 2012, and obviously you worked for John McCain at one point. You saw how effective they were in 2008 in terms of using technology. And I think they thought that the website would roll out easily because they were hiring the right people to do it. Clearly, they did not. Let's play a clip here, guys. Number seven, basically what it's going to talk about, or this is the president describing just how easy it was going to be to sign up for healthcare.gov. Roll the tape.
We'll allow consumers to go online and compare private healthcare insurance plans, just like you'd compare over the internet the best deal on flat screen TVs.
Buying health insurance is never going to be like buying a song on iTunes.
You can look at them side by side, just like you'd go online and compare cars.
You know, it's just a much more complicated transaction. Just visit healthcare.gov, and there you can compare insurance plans side by side, the same way you'd shop for a plane ticket on Kayak or a TV on Amazon. I don't think I'm stupid enough to go around saying this is going to be like shopping on Amazon or Travelocity.
I love it when they string together those sort of sound bites. It just shows you where this was and where it ended up. You know, the president yesterday, Douglas, it was a lot of people were commending him for taking responsibility, for saying, this is on me. He must have said that on at least three different occasions. But that last clip was very telling, where he said, look, I'm a pretty smart guy. If I had known that this was going to roll out the way it was, then it never, ever would have been launched on October 1st. I guess the question is, how didn't he know? Why didn't he just walk into a room where they were testing it and saying, hey, guys, how's this going on October 1st? Try to go on himself. Something. Why wasn't the execution there? Is that because the president is about symbolism, but when it comes to actually following through with things, he just doesn't seem interested? Or somebody dropped the ball in his cabinet, just isn't talking to him?
I think this is the most important question, and it's because it tells you that the president has a culture around him that doesn't tell him bad news that he needs to know. And it's caused him tremendous political problems and personal pain, obviously, in this instance. But it should have been the case that people were waving flags and saying, we have a problem with the website. The secretary of HHS should have known. The secretary should have told the president. And an informed president probably would have made a different decision. The fact that he found out after the fact says something is wrong with the culture of decision-making in the White House. And that troubles me because that's beyond health care. That's everything that he does, and he's the president of the United States. I worked in two White Houses, and I could not imagine that on the president's signature initiative, he was not fully informed of the state of play. That's remarkable to me.
You know, and we got about 30 seconds, so just a quick question. I'm reading Double Down now, and it's a great book, and it talks about how the president only met with his cabinet once in 2012, an election year, that he really seems to lean on his advisors. Is that part of the culture that you're talking about, that it's strictly about politics and not so much about execution?
Very much. My impression is that the policy people, the ones who are always the bearers of bad news in a political...
Hi, this is Mike Regan. You need to watch out.